Welcome. Before we begin, we ask that you please turn off your cell phones and electronic devices. Please remain seated while the class of 2019 enters the auditorium. Good afternoon. My name is Jeffrey Putman, and I am the Vice President for Student Affairs and Dean of Students for the College of Medicine. It is my pleasure to welcome you to our 21st annual White Coat Ceremony, which is sponsored by the College of Medicine and the Alumni Association of the College of Medicine. I would like to take this opportunity to thank one of our alumni, Dr. James Ferguson, and his wife, Mrs. Irene Ferguson, for their generous donation in support of this event. It is now my pleasure to introduce our new Dean of the College of Medicine, Dr. Carlos Patu.
Good afternoon, and welcome to the members of the class of 2019, your families, significant others, friends, Downstate administration, faculty, and the staff of the White Coat Ceremony. You are entering our College of Medicine at a time of great change, when the future of healthcare in our nation is a subject of much debate. In addition, you can look forward to an era of extraordinary and exciting medical discoveries and technological advances. There have been more scientific and technical advances in the past 50 years than in the entire history of the world. These advances will greatly enhance your ability to alleviate human suffering, but at the same time, you can expect to encounter a host of new medical and ethical dilemmas. We will do our best to prepare you to meet those challenges. We have a long tradition of training physicians who are skilled in treating not just the diseases of the body, but also the humanity of the person. For this reason, we celebrate the start of your medical education and career by giving each of you a white coat, one of the symbols of the physician's compassionate care. It is a profound truism that the best patient care is caring about our patients. The white coat is also a way for us to welcome you as a junior member of our profession. The white coat ceremony is a relatively recent innovation. Dr. Arnold Gold, a neurologist on the faculty at Columbia University's College of Physician Surgeons, started the white coat ceremony tradition in 1994. Dr. Gold thought that the Hippocratic Oath should be taken in the first day of medical school as well as the last. He was concerned that physicians were becoming more enamored by the technological aspects of medicine rather than listening to and caring for patients. He felt that the Hippocratic Oath should be taken by entering medical students to publicly commit at the outset of their careers to the kind of physicians they will become. In 1995, which was the second year of the program, the Gold Foundation expanded their sponsorship of the White Coat Ceremony to 7 medical schools, including SUNY Downstate. The Gold Foundation reports that the White Coat Ceremony now takes place in 97% of the AAMC-accredited schools of medicine in the United States and Canada, as well as osteopathic schools of medicine, and at schools at 13 other countries. This year, our White Coat speaker is Dr. Erika Schwartz. Dr. Schwartz is one of our very own, a 1975 graduate of SUNY Downstate. She was born in Bucharest, Romania, and graduated from high school in Rome, Italy, after which she immigrated to the US with her parents at the age of 16. She graduated NYU's cum laude on an academic scholarship, and from Downstate cum laude as a member of the Alpha Omega Alpha Medical Honor Society. Dr. Schwartz completed her residency in internal medicine and a fellowship in critical care at Kings County Hospital. And at the age of 28, she became director of trauma and emergency. She is a past president of SUNY Downstate's alumni board of managers from 2013 to 2014, and has served as a member of the board for 25 years. She is the recipient of many awards of excellence. A consummate clinician and fierce patient advocate, her passion is teaching doctors and medical students how to develop close and responsible relationships with their patients. We congratulate you, Dr. Schwartz, on your outstanding achievements and believe that your stellar career and words of advice will inspire our audience and especially the class of 2019. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Erika Schwartz as our White Coat speaker.
Thank you. Wow, that was a very nice presentation. Thank you. Hello, everybody. Good afternoon. How are you feeling? Thank you, Dean Patu. Thank you, President Williams, Dean Putman. Thank you, class of 2019, friends, family, everybody here. First, let me tell you what an honor it is for me to be standing here in front of you today. I spent a lot of time trying to figure out how I can share with you in this unique day and maybe help inspire you in some small way with a true and passionate message that can last and a message that can stay with you for the next 4 years. I found this to be a very difficult task because today is a day you and your families and friends will never forget, regardless of what I say. It's such a momentous occasion. It certainly stands on its own. It marks the start of the most life-defining 4 years of your life. You've worked so hard for so many years to get here today. The process of getting here has been grueling, highly competitive, and even isolating. Most of you probably know you wanted to be doctors long before others. Like, you knew when you wanted to be doctors from the time you were kids. Some of you just figured it out as you got older. It gives me pause, literally, to think about how difficult it is to get into medical school today. And yet, look at you. You are here. You're unequivocally the chosen ones. That's right. Take a breath. Think about it. And it's such a joy to just look at your faces. And when I was walking down the hallway, and I was looking at you, and you're so full of excitement, hope, promise. It's amazing. It actually makes me cry. You are our future, and you will define what the future looks like in healthcare. It's pretty impressive, huh? You're starting medical school in a time of major change. This is a very difficult time to become a doctor in our country. To be part of the class of 2019, you must not only excel academically, you must be dedicated and committed to overcoming so many obstacles to becoming truly an impactful physician. You are coming in at a time when healthcare is in such tremendous turmoil. The position and role of the doctor, which was so clear 40 years ago, is now confusing and confused. The priorities of the industry have changed dramatically. Insurance companies, drug companies, academic institutions, all parties involved with healthcare have their own agendas and will be pulling you in their direction. At the end of the next 4 years, as you finish medical school, you will come out a very different person, but hopefully only from the standpoint of more knowledge, better understanding of your profession, and clearer perspective on the healthcare system. What I hope doesn't change is what the look on your faces expresses today. Excitement, promise, hope. Fortunately, you're part of a new breed of doctors that carry the mandate of change and the commitment to improve the way healthcare is delivered in this country. You are literally pioneers on the frontier of the new medicine that is starting to take shape now. Seriously, really seriously. Medicine has changed dramatically over the past 50 years, as Dr. Patu just mentioned. We've waxed extreme from a uniquely relationship-driven type of practice to a technologically advanced and financially driven system. The time has come for us to bring these extremes together. Only when these two models of medical practice are integrated will we truly deliver great healthcare. And you are the instruments of this critical change. This change can only be implemented by you and will be determined by your relationship with your patients. You may think this is premature for me to say that because you haven't seen a patient yet. But this is a perfect time for you to hear the message, I promise. Just stay with me and I'll show you the very few but crucial ingredients you need to internalize, absorb, and live by to become the best doctors anyone could ever hope for. In the next few minutes, and I'm only speaking for 15 minutes, I'm going to share some of my experiences with patients that have deeply impacted me and the direction my practice of medicine has taken, leading me to become the kind of doctor I am, which I hope will serve to inspire you as well. What I'm about to tell you cannot be found in the medical school curriculum, although you have a great new curriculum to look forward to. It's something that you have to figure out as an individual process, because it's about who you are first as a human being and then as a doctor. You will figure out your specialty a lot faster and sooner, but who you are, the kind of doctor you are, the impact you make on your patients will take a long time to understand, to really figure out, to be able to process. That process is part of your journey, your individual journey. Medicine is not just a career, a trade, or even, as we say, a profession. It's a life calling, a passion. It will define you as a human being, not just as a doctor. Let's use today to just stop for a moment. I want you to take stock of who you are right now, today. Just stop and think. Why have you worked so hard and sacrificed so much to get here? What motivated you to be so passionate and determined? How come you, out of tens of thousands who applied, you are now the class of 2019, see? Spend a moment and hold on tight to that most important part of you, the human being sitting here in front of me, raring to go, but don't go yet. Let's talk together. How are you feeling? I don't hear you. Be clearer. How are you feeling?
Great.
I want you to know that these four words you just uttered, that I uttered, and you replied to, are the most important four words of your career. So let me explain. This is when we start to talk, actually. I'm going to start with when I was a little girl in Romania, where I was born, and you already know. Our family doctor used to make house calls. I remember to this day, 60 years ago, that the man was a wonderful old man. He had gray hair, he had these warm, big hands, he had kind eyes, and I actually really used to look forward to him coming and making house calls. Can you imagine that? Even at 5, I understood at some subliminal level that he was there to take care of me. He would examine me and then, more often than not, give me a shot. It was usually penicillin because fortunately for me, yes, I was born after penicillin was invented, discovered. Surprisingly, I was never scared or afraid of our old house call making doctor. After he was done with me, he would sit at the kitchen table with my mother and they'd have a cup of coffee together. I have no idea what they were talking about, no. But I could tell you that they looked very comfortable and they had a lot in common. Actually, he was part of the community. He was a member of the family, a friend. In fact, he went to weddings, to funerals. He was kind of omnipresent in our lives. Well, those days are long gone. Medicine has changed a lot. As it changed, we went from having few or no tools for diagnosing and treating disease to becoming experts and specialists. And technologically, we're so advanced. We have genetic testing, CAT scanners, MRIs, blood tests to drown the entire earth in. Advanced surgical procedures, lasers, robots, radiation, chemo, certainly amazing stuff has been developed. On one hand, that is great, and it helps us provide highly advanced care. But on the other hand, in the process, we traded the human touch. This kind of trade is just too extreme. The outcome is a huge canyon, a chasm that led to a terribly dangerous disconnect between the doctor and the patient. Suddenly, we're faced with a system where the most important in the system is also the most overlooked, the patient. The patient and the doctor are no longer sitting at the proverbial kitchen table talking, and very few doctors show up at their patients' weddings and funeral. In fact, too often, the relationship has become adversarial. That just doesn't work. In fact, from where I stand, I honestly and strongly believe this disconnect is one of the primary reasons our healthcare system is in such shambles. The wrong priorities define the kind of care we provide. But don't worry. The good news is that you can change the system. You, each one of you, each one of us, can make it better. Remember, you guys are the agents of change. So let me go back in time again, just wake you up a little bit. When I first went into private practice, I remember a guy coming into my office, and he said, my usual greeting, you already know it. What did I say to him? How are you feeling? I said, how can I help you? And the man looks at me. And I'm really young at this point. Not young by your standards, but young by our standards. I'm like 30. And he says to me, how should I know? You're the doctor. A light bulb literally goes off inside my head. And I go, wait a minute. How should I know? You're the patient. I don't live inside your body. I have no way to know what's going on inside your body. So how could I possibly be able to tell what's wrong with you? If you tell me, though, how you feel, I probably will be able to start working with you. And together, we can try to figure out what's really going on inside of you. I don't think the guy got it. But I did. Doctors, remember this one, don't live inside the patient. So unless you communicate really well, we don't stand a chance of helping the patient. So I understood then I need to be able to communicate with the patient. And the patient needs to understand that even though I have an MD after my name, I'm not a mind reader. Shortly after that incident, I started questioning things like if we're spending 5 to 10 minutes with a patient in the frenzy to make money working for an insurance company, a drug company, anyone but the patient, how can we honestly expect to help the patient? How can I just write a prescription for a patient and tell him what to do when I don't even know him? How's his family? His job? What does he eat? Does he sleep? Does he work out? What's stressing him? How many kids is she putting through school? Honestly, you can get the answers to these questions in 3 minutes. And they certainly will put the $1 million blood and MRI workup into context. And if I don't know the patient, why would he and she listen to me? Just because I'm a doctor? Seriously? Those days are also gone, long gone. Nobody believes the doctor knows best anymore. And you know what? They're right. We don't. So what's wrong with that expectation? Let's move on a little bit further. Again, years back, when I was still in my 30s, I was in my 30s for about 10 years. Are you listening? I'm glad to hear that. Yes. I went into private practice. Thank you. I'm grateful to you guys. I went into private practice. Doctors I had been working with in the hospital, after I finished running the trauma center, took pity of me because I didn't have any patients. So someone sent me a woman in her 50s with end-stage breast cancer. She had undergone chemo, radiation, surgery. There was nothing left for the conventional medical system to do for her. So my buddies, of course, sent her to me. At the time, I had just ended the 5 years running the trauma center at a major academic center, and I'd gone into private practice in internal medicine, and I really wasn't very knowledgeable or clear on what to do with people when you can no longer do things to them anymore. It's very tough. You'll see that soon enough. So the woman came in crying. It was October, and she was saying she wasn't going to see Thanksgiving. I felt terribly guilty. I was young, all my life was ahead of me, and here she was at the end of hers. It seemed to me so unfair that here she was on her last days and I had nothing to offer. But because I was trained to believe I'm a healer, a physician who has to find something, anything to do, I couldn't just let her leave. I just felt terrible. So I had to think very hard. I have no idea how I came up with this then, but now I can tell you, it came from my heart. So I said to her, if you think you're going to die before Thanksgiving, why don't you just have Thanksgiving next week? Bring your family together and see what happens. The woman stopped crying and looked at me. After what happened seemed to be like a really long time, but it was only a few seconds, she said, I never thought of doing that. Nobody ever mentioned this to me. So I hesitated and told her the truth, because I'm pretty transparent. I said, I really have nothing else to tell you, so I thought maybe this would help. Now brace yourselves. She tried it. She had Thanksgiving in October. And she stayed my patient. And she didn't die. In fact, she lived another 20 years. She lived to dance at her daughter's wedding. The cancer never came back. I never did anything about the cancer. But I made another little connection. I made the connection that you don't always have to do something medical. You don't always have to give meds, radiate, operate, do a test. You just don't. You need to learn to stop and listen to the patient, to see the patient like your mother, your sister, your grandmother, just another human being, just like you. Then you're probably going to come up with a common sense solution for the moment, because all we all have is this moment. I'm not going to delay the moment, although I would like to because it's really great, but this is all we have, this moment. And if you don't have any idea what to do, I have a solution for you. Just empathize. Feel for real. Feel for the patient, because you know what? They are you. Today, you know how to empathize better than you will 4 years from now. I promise to you that that is a fact. You are experts at feeling. Hold on to that expertise, please. So let's go on. Made that point, right? Next. I've been very fortunate in my career because I've seen a lot of patients and I've learned so much from them. Eventually, I got out of acute medicine and internal medicine because they were all about waiting for patients to get sick, from my perspective. But I want to tell you that it took me 25 years to get out of it, 20 years to get out of it. In our culture and medical training, disease, unfortunately, has the highest status. And I decided that maybe disease shouldn't have the highest status, and maybe keeping people healthy was a higher status, at least for me and my patients. From my perspective, life is a continuum of health with small interruptions when you get sick. But I wanted to worry less about disease, and I wanted to help people stay healthy and enjoy life. But that's after 20 years of knowing what disease is. But before I got there, I was on call one night in my late 30s, and I remember another interesting turning point story. And this is the last story, I promise. This woman came in with a little girl who was about 10 years old. The little girl had blue skin from her neck down to her waist. The rest of her body was just fine. Her arms were blue too. She didn't have any shortness of breath. She didn't have any blood pressure problems. Was speaking perfectly well. When I asked the girl how she was feeling, she said, fine, and smiled. The mom was concerned, so I examined the kid from head to toe and couldn't come up with anything wrong. How are you feeling? I said, clueless as to the cause of the blue trunk. Finally, I took a 4x4 sponge, I soaked it in hot water and some soap, and I just rubbed the girl's forearm, and guess what? The blue just came right off. So I asked the mom if the girl wore a blue sweater or a blue sweatshirt. And the mom said, oh, yeah. So I said, did she get wet while wearing it? And the mother said, yeah, we just got caught in the rain this afternoon, right before I turned her turn blue. So I said, just take your daughter home, give her a shower, and don't worry about it. Just soap her up. It'll all come off. It's just the dye that ran off the sweatshirt. On their way out, the mom, highly relieved, and the daughter happy I didn't poke her too much, the little girl looked at my name tag. It said, E. Schwartz. It's my name. The little girl said, what does the E stand for? And I said, Erica. The kid says, oh my God, my dog's name is Erica. So we both laughed. And for a second, I realized something that for the following 30 years of my life has affected the way I practice medicine every day. I realized the little girl and I had connected at a level where the little girl and I were equals. The 10-year-old and me, the doctor, were pals. We had something in common. My name's Erica, her dog's name's Erica. Suddenly, the distance between me, the doctor, and her, the 10-year-old patient, disappeared and was replaced by the similarity between the two of us. We were both just two human beings sharing a personal anecdote, and she felt safe. So these little stories I shared with you should give you a little insight into what really makes the difference in the practice of medicine. Over the next 4 years, you're going to study a lot of advanced, esoteric, very important scientific facts. You will become experts, experts in various areas of medicine. You will understand biochemistry, physiology, anatomy, pathology, genetics, genomics, you name it. And you will understand very difficult concepts, how the human body works, how drugs work. You will become experts at diagnosing disease. You will become experts at treating disease. And while we're on the topic of disease, let me tell you one thing. Don't treat disease. The disease doesn't need your help. Treat patients. The patients need your help. And finally, at the end of your training, you will become part of the hierarchy that is our medical profession. Some of you will become interested in research. Some will become clinicians. Some of you will work for drug companies or insurance companies, while some of you will be very clear they have become doctors for only one reason. Just like I did 40 years ago, you two can decide to only work for the patient, to listen to the patient, to respect the patient, to connect with the patient, to never scare the patient, and to honestly, unequivocally, undoubtedly, and all the time, serve the patient. And you know what? I never regretted making that decision. I never got burnt out. That decision has served me really well. I just love what I do. I wake up every morning excited to go to work. That's because I love my patients, and they love me. And medicine, at the end of the day, no matter how scientific or lucrative it is an art. It's the art of listening and the art of caring. And it's the art of being compassionate. So I wish you all a great career. I wish you a great 4 years, at the end of which I hope you come out as human and as caring, as passionate about saving the world as you are today. Congratulations. And don't forget about those four lines, defining word. How are you feeling? Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Schwartz, for those words. And now I'm delighted to present to you the class of 2019. Will the following faculty members please come forward and take your places? Sophie Cristoforo, Associate Dean for Student and Curricular Affairs, will read the names of the members of the class of 2019. Dr. Robin Ovich, Assistant Dean for Clinical Competencies, and Dr. Andrew Adler, Associate Director for Clinical Competencies, will assist the members of the class with their white coats.
When your name is called, please come forward to be coded by Dr. Adler or Dr. Ovich. Brandon Adelson, Alam Ahmed, C. Sara Akter. Ikra Ekram. Hadi Alas. Sujay Alvinkar. Emmanuel Amofa. Patrick Arthur. Sadid Assad. Laisha Atkinson. Zaki Azam. Alize Aziz. Pratik Bagel. John Barlog. Layla Bayat. Jane Belyaskava. Muhammad Bhutta. Leah Byland. We'll all applaud at the end. Emily Carbaugh. Frank Cortella. Rebecca Caesar. William Chan. Joseph Chapman. Michael Chen. Dennis Cherkelin. Stephen Chung. Stephen Cho, Michael Christie. Jessica Crystalline, Albert Chu. John Connors. Sarah Quarterman. Kellyanne Cummings. Matthew Custodio. Andrew Danziger. Eitan Davuzadeh. Paige DeRosa, Sean Danraj. Anna Dickstein, Zachary Douglas. Morgan Drucker, Richie Dubay. Matthew Epstein. Lisa Feit. John Filtes. William Fike. Michelle Garcia. Maylot Gibra Michael. Solomon Geitz-Halls, Jingjing Gang. Sahul Gonzalez Perez, Erica Griffith. Joseph Grunfeld, Margaret Zukowski. Rosina Haile, Nicholas Harris. Alice Hawkins, Melissa Hirsch. Ziwa Ho, Crystal Holt. Allison Huang, Shirley Hui. Ivana Ilich, Mohammed Islam. Joseph Jacob, Jonathan J. Group. Amy Jen, William G. Edwin Jimenez, Chanel Jonas. Alexander Jonokochi, Shahada Chabariti, Ishure Gatugumpala, David Kim. Joseph Kim, Robert Kim, Spencer Kim, Sun Su Kim, Nikki Kimura, Max Klein. Anna Kozlova, Catherine Kwong. Mohith Kumar, Joshua Kurian. Jonas Kwok, Huckchan Steve Kwan. Ingyu Lee, Yeonju Lee. Diana Lennis Lopez, Renata Lehrer. Michael Levine, Eric Lee. Jessica Lee.
Yeah, Jess.
Shuo Li. Jeremy Lin Alyssa Liu. David Liu, Kevin Lopez. Marsha Liu, Helen Leo. Jessica Magarinos. Nikita Malikov. Michael Mann. Shella Martyr. Michael McGee. Ryan McLaughlin. Pakina Mekki, James Messina. Shifra Mincer, Elizabeth Mochia. Rochelle Modeste, Nikita Mogar. Timothy Morello, Benjamin Morrison. Kiriana Morse, Ivan Navanho. Eric Nelson, Kyle Norder. Yitzhak Norowitz, Zachary Olmsted. Ellen Osaney, Karen Paltu. Gregory Park, Sang Mi Julie Park. Kush Patel, Parth Patel. Yogesh Patel, Mariana Pavliha. Alexandra Pfister, Caroline Pham. Gregory Phillips, Kyla Pinak. Eldine Pupovich, Caroline Rago. Shahodi Rahman, Benjamin Ramalanzona. Nailed it. Catherine Rimple. Joel Rosine. Victor Ruan, Eric Ruff. Aaron Saxton, Sarah Schmidt, Smits. Kim Schoenfeld, Scott Schoeninger. Ezra Schrag, Zeef Schwartz. Joseph Scolin, Doya Shalavi. Amna Sheikh, Rachel Sheshkir. Edward Shi, Francis Shi. Alina Stridler, Sufana Siddiqui. Gershrun Singh, Karnveer Singh. Suk Chang Singh, Emily Smith. Kayvon Sobani, Ellen Song. Ray Song, Anthony Sorrentino. Christina Sorrento, Eric Sprung. Sarah Stroud, Calvin Tan. Kenny Tang, York Tang. Sochi Thacker, Gregory Toy. Sue Ki Sang, Cindy Tsui. Elliot Turku, Ariel Ehrman. Christopher Valenti, Matthew Vitale. Alexandra Walasek, Philip Wan. Erica Waples, Izumi Watanabe. Emily Watkins, Bradford Willicks. Jackie Shong, Patriot Yang. Anchi Yao, Fahd Yazdani. Alan Yevtikov, Christopher Yakos. Clark Zhang, Naveed Ziyoe. Congratulations, class of 2019.
My pleasure to welcome to the podium Dr. Jean McCrae, our Senior Associate Dean for Academic Affairs, who will administer the Hippocratic Oath.
Will the members of the class of 2019 please rise? And any physician members of the audience who wish to renew their Hippocratic Oath, would you also please rise? The oath is printed in your programs. Please raise your right hand and recite the words of the Hippocratic Oath with me. I do solemnly swear by that which I hold most sacred, that I will be loyal to the profession of medicine and just and generous to its members, that I will lead my life and practice my art in uprightness and honor, that whatever house I shall enter, it shall be for the good of the sick, to the utmost of my power, that I will hold myself aloof from wrong, that I will exercise my art solely for the cure of my patients, and will give no drug and perform no operation for a wrongful purpose, that whatsoever I shall see or hear of the lives of men and women that should not be spoken, I will keep secret. These I do promise, and in proportion as I am faithful to this my oath, may happiness and good repute be ever mine.
This concludes our 21st annual White Coat Ceremony. Please join us for a reception in the Grove, which is immediately outside of this auditorium. Will the members of the audience please remain in their seats while the class of 2019 exits first, followed by the audience. Thank you very much.